good afternoon. Very good to see you too.
Yeah.
It would be great to meet all of you actually, but I think this is the next best thing.
Yes. So we welcome you, ma'am. So here I give a short introduction of both of them. So Khyrunnisa is an award-winning writer of children's fiction and also writes for adults. She created the popular comic character Butterfingers for Tingle and Tinkle and authored the hilarious Butterfinger series of books for older children published by Penguin Random House. The Howard's Butterfingers is her first novel and recently published smash hit Butterfingers is the seventh in series. Her first book for adults is the best-selling Tongue-in-Cheek, The Funny Side of Life, a humorous take on misadventures of urban women, The Lizard of Oz and other stories. The Crocodile Who Ate the Butter Chicken for Breakfast and other stories and Baby, Dub Dub are some of her recent books. Khyrunnisa worked as an associate professor of English at All Saints College, Thiruvananthapuram, and now is a full-time writer. We welcome you, ma'am. And here is the moderator, Sunita Sinha. She is an English subject head, certified career counselor, a senior listener, story spinner, and disruptive thinker. She is skilled in research, teaching, leadership, public speaking, and curricular development. She designs and develops learning solutions that integrates technology, creativity, and problem solving in daily learning. She has been actively implementing STEAM or STEM project for empowering the essence of education. She is also a passionate writer. Her key areas involve skills, mythology, modernism, symbolism, and spirituality. She believes in the following: knowledge is like a sinking star. The odyssey never fails to fascinate. The destination hardly matters. We welcome you, ma'am. Over to you.
Thank you. That was like a huge, frightening introduction.
I think you need a session all for yourself, Sunita.
No, not at all.
With all this.
It's a delight to, converse with you and keep up that, it's absolutely fantastic and a lot of generosity I can see there. Okay, so that was great.
Sara, all our pleasure.
Yeah. So we will begin with, so Khyrunnisa, I think I have been looking at what you have been writing. And one thing that struck me is the ability to laugh, humor, and post pandemic where we are just trying to come back, with all these losses, everything, emotional, social, financial, we are trying to come back. Your books are like a breath of fresh minty air, if I may say it's like that. So humor is your hallmark, if I may say, whatever, whether it's your Butterfingers or Tongue-in-Cheek. Yes.
Yes. Thank you very much, Sunita. And before I start answering your question, I think I have to thank the wonderful ladies behind. I don't know whether there are gents also, I'm sure, who are behind this venture, Adventures of the Literati. Snehi, I always feel like it's conjugating a verb, Sneha, Snehi, it goes on like that. And Priyanka, thank you very much for this initiative. It's a season two. I think you had a wonderful season one. That's probably why you have season two. And I hope season two is also lives up to your expectations and you go on to season three, four, five, six, and so on. So thank you very much for hosting me on screen. Yes. So delighted to be here. And now Sunita, really impressed by all those lovely things that Sneha said about you. I think I should get to know more about you. I love this, that knowledge is like a shooting star, because knowledge is very, very, very important for me also, because we should always be in pursuit of knowledge. Now, coming to your question about humor, one thing is that we are not post-COVID, Sunita. We are still DC during COVID. There is DC. During COVID, and now there is this South African mutant variant that is doing the rounds, so it's very frightening, and I don't know how long we are going to battle this virus, but you said that my books are like a breath of fresh air. I'm glad it is not a breath of infected air, because we are all wearing masks. At least when you're reading my books, you can remove your mask and read and laugh and enjoy yourself. Yes, humor is what drives my books, because I've always loved humor. And it's also because I grew up in a large family. I mean, I don't mean to say that if you grow up in a large family, you will be laughing all the time. I'm the youngest of eight children. And all of us, we seven girls and one boy. So please have pity on my dear brother, second in the run. So we used to constantly talk, bicker, you know, and we all love to read. So this, there was this, and being the youngest, I always had to hold my own. You have people, there will be reparties, there will be fun things said, and you need to keep on honing your humor skills to be able to reply, to retaliate, and to engage in repartee. So those kind of things were happening, but I would say it's primarily because we all loved reading. It was, and I had a weakness for humor books. I love reading. I read all kinds of books, but humor is my weakness, you could say, or my strength. I do not know how you would like to put it, but I love humor. And so unconsciously, it was not conscious. Unconsciously, it was developing in me. And whenever I write something in school, we used to have a period called composition. Now it could be creative writing. Yes. That is when you exhibit your creativity, your creative skills. We write stories, we write letters, no letters happening any longer. But in those days, we were taught letter writing, formal letter, informal letter. Formal letter, you can't be humorous and funny when you're writing to somebody, you know, who is the head of something. But in the informal letters, I would let myself go. And whatever I was writing, I would like to inject, infuse some humor into it. It was something like a compulsion for me. And therefore, when I started writing, naturally, it was humor. And I'm extremely happy that my tongue-in-cheek, people are calling it a stress buster for COVID times. Mm-hmm. Because when I wrote it, it wasn't, there was no COVID, not a whiff of COVID at all. It was just the misadventures of an urban woman, which is me, all right? I love to laugh at myself because then no one will be annoyed. And there's much to laugh at in me. And that is what the book is. That is why I'm happy that humor is helping people at such a time. It has got a therapeutic effect. And also, I feel that we take ourselves a little too seriously sometimes. And we need to laugh at ourselves. We need to laugh at things around us. We don't need to mock. I always make that distinction. No sarcasm, no mocking, no humiliating. But it should be genial humor. Ha 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 humor maybe, but sometimes tongue-in-cheek humor, subtle humor, different kinds of humor, but humor. Not that I can't write seriously. I can. But when I did write a couple of stories that were serious, mm-hmm. a student of mine told me, ma'am, this is not you. So kind of stuck in humor.
So I'm glad that you shared this because it reminds me when you spoke about your composition, you know, how you do, we still have that in our schools and we still get that, you know.
What
that,
do you call that?
We have our, we have our paper, like for example, we have our creative writing, narrative, descriptive writing, where they can, you know, write stories. There are also creative writing components where they can write. And I personally, myself, I love humor. In fact, in my classrooms, I make it a point that, you know, humor is used. For example, I always say that, you know, you may be having fun with the paper, but the marks don't agree with you. So, you know, that's how I try to swallow the bitter pills. We have all this. So yes. I think it keeps alive the feeling. And humor is a great buster as far as even conflict resolution. So that, yes. I'm so glad. You know,
it's also an icebreaker, you know, when you are meeting somebody, somebody cracks a joke, which is natural. And then everybody laughs and then you start talking.
You forget about what were the, you know, the little bumps which were
exactly.
there.
Exactly.
And the thing is that we know about, you know, when I was just looking at your books, looking at them, we know that humor for us, and especially being in English, I'm sure you are aware, and all of us who are, otherwise also who love to read, that we think about the Punch magazine, we think about P.G. Woodhouse. So, you know, humor bites, which bite at times, you know, you feel a little bit of, okay, maybe I need to, the rhetorical question type comes in. Your humor is healing, right?
It is.
I'm sure it is. So because that comes from a strong sense of self-security, because the ability to laugh at oneself actually showcases how strong you are. then only I think we can laugh at ourselves. Because we refuse to laugh at ourselves because we think, oh, if I laugh at myself, maybe my I'll be going down in someone's level or my productivity will be questioned, et cetera, et cetera. But it showcases how strong you are, how confident you are. So how did that develop, you know, this ability to laugh and not only to laugh at oneself, to so share it so confidently with the world, with the readers that, okay, you know, it's great, laugh at yourself and yet come out. Right.
Yeah. Now, you mentioned punch, PGODOWs.
Yeah.
I love them. Punch is no longer there. It's not delivering its punch any longer. Yeah. I think in the early 2000, 20th century, it stopped. There was a brief in between also in the 90s thereabouts, it stopped and then restarted and then again stopped. But it was a mid 19th century phenomenon, you should say. It was wonderful, and they are the ones who first brought in the concept of cartoon in its in its modern sense of something funny through pictures. Otherwise, cartoon had another meaning, something on a cardboard or something like that. But so Punch delivers its punch. It started from the name was from Punch and Judy.
Yeah,
but you know, if you look at what how they were evolving, how the magazine was evolving, you realize that from showing comic pictures of Punch and Judy, they went on to the boxing glove, meaning punch.
Punch again.
So they do in there. So they have all kinds of humor. They kind of experiment with everything. Sometimes it is really satirical. Sometimes it is bitter. Sometimes it is very erudite, very intellectual. You need to really know the background to understand. So
It allowed you to explore the types of humor which were henceforth not many of us know.
Yes. So it was a wonderful thing. I feel so sorry that a magazine like that had to die. Mm-hmm. But anyway, all good things come to an end. And that's what happened with Punch. But when it comes to P.G. Woodhouse, P.G. Woodhouse died, but his books will never die. And I love P.G. Woodhouse. I mean, his books.
Yes.
He has written almost 100 books. I discovered him in class 8. And I still read him. Because always on my dining table, there is one Woodhouse. I have about 60 books of P.G. Woodhouse. Okay. It's my favorite collection. I hide them. You know why? Because people who borrow books seem to think that once you borrow, you can. This is the first step towards making their own library.
And Woodhouse may never come back.
Will never come back. Not even May. I think he'll never come back.
Never comes back. Yeah, I'm sure.
I hide them and I enjoy them. And maybe Woodhouse was an unconscious influence. Woodhouse, Gerald Durrell.
Yes,
Jerome.
Yeah.
Then now Bill Bryson. Even Marquez, has his sense of humor, Salman Rushdie. So you have all of them using humor, but in P.G. Woodhouse and Jerome K. Jerome and Gerald Durrell, it's a constant. It is there from beginning to end, especially P.G. Woodhouse. From the first word to the last, there is a humor. And that plus my love for humor by itself, because I discovered P.G. Woodhouse only in the 8th standard. I think I read Three Men in a Boat when I was in the class six.
Even I think, yeah.
So we are actually, we're growing up like that. I was growing up like that. And that is probably why when I first started writing, and I told you that whenever I wrote, I was trying to bring humor in. Yeah. And I was not really, I didn't want to become a writer. Meaning, it was not my ambition. People ask me, when did you want to become a writer? Was it your ambition when you were in school or when I was a baby? Imagine saying, I want to become a writer, because that's what is happening these days. 3-year-olds are becoming writers. Yeah, so there's nothing like that. But books, love books. Literature was my first love. And I wanted to be associated with books. I had to fight at home, argue a lot to take literature for my BA, because they wanted me to do science. They wanted me to become a doctor. One sister was a doctor, so we need one more doctor in the house, a backup. And I said,
original choices were like, okay, you have to do that or this. Literature.
Yeah, you know how it is.
Yes.
Yeah, it has to be medicine, engineering or medicine. If it is arts, you have to sit for the central services exam. You know, that's how it works. Nothing beyond that. Anyway, my father backed me and I did literature. I wanted to become a teacher. I wanted to be in touch with my books. That is one way in which I could. So for a year or so, I taught in a school. Then I had a brief stint in the Punjab National Bank as an officer. And very good job, everybody said. Everyone frowned and raised their eyebrows when I resigned. How can you resign from such a well-paying job, well-paid job? You know how it is. Yes. Money is the thing.
Yes.
And I'm going to take up teaching in a college where I was going to get one third the salary I was getting in the bank. I was fine with it. I said, I'll live within my means, but I want to get back to teaching. And there too, when I was teaching, I used to try to make my classes interesting by bringing humor in. And so when you talked about P.G. Woodhouse, I wouldn't say P.G. Woodhouse's humor is also pretty genial.
Yes, it is.
It's not biting.
No, it doesn't.
It's swift. He is really...
And you need to be fast to just catch it. You know, might slip this night if you're not used to it.
Yes,
exactly. And later you realize, oh my God, I slipped that.
I know. Because everything, and you need to know literature to understand P.G. Woodhouse. Because it's full of references. A lot of his humor is generated through literary references. Okay. So all that is actually keeping your brain also ticking when you're reading. It's not just entertainment. He's doing a lot to you and you feel good. So all that together probably made me hone my skills in writing humor so that when I wrote my first story, as I told you, I didn't really want to become a writer. It happened quite by accident much later in life. I was teaching, my son was small, and then we used to get Tinkle at home, and I sent this entry for a competition for adult writers of children's fiction. So not just like that, let me write a story. Naturally, it had to be humor. Almost naturally, it had to be about sports because I love sports. Follow most sports, read the paper, newspaper back to front, therefore miss holiday notices on the first page. So that is a harm. So I thought, okay, fine, I will write a story which is cricket based because that is what I know best. And then let it be a sheer story. And I thought I will bring a Butterfingers as my main character.
And after that, tinkled with laughter. And it kept on tinkling.
Yes. And then Tinkle asked me for a few years later whether I could create a regular character for Tinkle.
Great.
And this guy, Butterfingers, has been living in my head. I have created a few other characters in different stories. I didn't write too many. Every year I used to send an entry for this competition and then Children's Book Trust. Beyond that, I was so in. You know how it is when you're teaching. It takes up all your time. Preparation, reading, then teaching, then looking after the home at the same time and evaluating. I was listening to Ruskin Bond's, one of his interviews some time back, I think it, or what's his Tata Live, I don't know, where he was saying that he writes so much in the morning.
Yes.
Before breakfast. He loves to see the sun has to come through the window. His bed is near the window and then he writes so much. And I was thinking that luxury I cannot have because for me, the first thing I need to do after I get up is to fix breakfast. So I have to make breakfast. So you are trying to write, finding time to write in the middle of so many things. That was what is happening. And so I wrote, brought back Butterfingers and Tinkle was happy. It became a huge success, a really huge success. It ran from 2006 to 2015. So that was how it started.
So great. I mean, and the way I think it is going, your multitasking, I think maybe the drive is always there in, you know, you never had the ambition, but, you know, rather than being driven, the driver said that, okay, I need to make a difference, be it among the students in the classroom or now the world, you know, the entire, it's opened up.
Yes.
It started there, but it has opened up and all of us are getting inspired together. Yeah. And that's a wonderful thing.
Yeah.
So coming to your, the name, you know, which is, I don't know, Butterfingers, the first time I read about it and I, you know, it just came, I don't know why Uncle Podger came to my head, you know, because I just thought about that today when everything slips. And then I realized that Butterfingers, the name is quite there. And of course, I'm sure there is a little bit of history behind it. So please enlighten us on that, because maybe that question has been asked many times, but still I'm going to ask it because for the audience.
No, people generally, what they ask is, did you invent this name? It sounds like something that has been created, you know, by somebody.
Yeah.
So I said, much as I would love to take the credit of having thought of this name, Butterfingers, I have to be truthful. It is not my creation. It has always, it's been there in the English language for a long time. And I thought that it was Charles Dickens who wrote it first. In Pickwick Papers, he mentions Butterfingers. He uses it as hyphenated, Butterfingered, I think he writes. But Then later, I did some more research on how this butterfingers came at all. And then I found it was there in the 17th century. The first time it was used was in 43, 45, when Gervase Markham wrote a book called The Good Housewife. The Good Housewife, right? He delineates what a good housewife would be like. I'm sure all the women will be up in arms when they read this book, a man telling what a good housewife should be like. She should have a good nose to smell. She should not do, she should be clean. She should smell good. And she should not be butterfingered.
Butterfingered.
That meaning she should not destroy the crockery in the house. Probably that's what the man
is concerned about. Everything.
Yeah, does should not be clumsy. So that early this word has come with the same meaning of being clumsy, dropping things as if you have butter in your hands. And at home, I came to know about this because my sisters, I told you, we use that word often. And whenever somebody drops something, we call that person butterfinger. Butterfingers. And that is why when I thought of a character for my story, I thought, let me have a character whose nickname is Butterfingers, because on the cricket field, it would be fun to have a main character who has butterfingers. He can drop a catch. Yes. He can be the one responsible for how the game changes. So many things. I could think of humorous situations if I have a character who is already humorous, because everybody, you know how it is. When somebody drops something, when somebody falls, you laugh, but after ensuring that person has not broken anything, meaning any part of his body, because then you don't laugh. So even laughter, we are very cautious, careful when we laugh. And that is how I thought of Butterfingers. I never expected it to become such a huge favorite. But children loved Butterfingers because they said they can relate to the character.
It is really.
Yeah, because he's an intelligent boy, but he's not first in class. He's not driven by this desire to perfect himself in academics, because he generously allows other people to be first. Only then, you know, you have to be at the bottom. There should be somebody at the bottom for others to be 1, 2, 3. So that is how he looks at it. He loves sports. He's an outdoor person. He wants to help people. So children realize that here is a rather imperfect character. Seriously, this is not a nerd. This is not a boy who always wants to study and do well and do good. He wants to do good, but I couch it in humor. You know, it's so that is probably why it has struck a chord, not just among children, but among older people also, because it takes them back to their school life, they say.
So, you know what? I really like Butterfingers. The reason is, and the best thing is, it is unfortunate that report cards define kids. It shouldn't be like that.
Yes.
Yeah. You must look at the child as a whole and not only at, you know, academic retention of certain concepts. That never defines. It's the skill, it's the individuality. And Butterfingers like that, I think, is the one who will be able to handle life in that buttery way. Because no matter how great you are in 90% with your report card, if you cannot handle life, you know, at that time it doesn't matter.
Yeah. The practical reality
where skills are required. You know, you need that on the spot thinking, how can I do that?
Yeah.
So I think that's the reason children find it so realistic, because there's so many of us know that, okay, Butterfingers may be at some point me. I have also gone through that, and your books maybe, you know, throwing that bit of light. It's okay. You can be clumsy, you can slip, but you can still be at the end and you come back.
Yeah, because he finally wins in the end.
Yes.
That's because it's a children's story. Somebody asked me, a child, why don't you have Butterfingers losing a match in the end?
That's a wonderful question.
Yeah, it's a wonderful question. So then I was a little taken aback. At the same time, I thought it was a wonderful question, but then I had to explain why. And I said, just like you have in Amitabh Bachchan's movies, where the hero takes on so many villains at the same time, dum-dum, and then, you know, bashes them up, and he finally comes out triumphant. If he didn't, the public will be very disappointed. They want the hero to win.
Okay.
Because, you want your hero to win. In fact, I remember first when I was writing, I think it was the second story or third story, where I was writing about some other boy who was getting the winning goal. Mm-hmm. And I had given it to a friend to read. And he said, look, you don't have to be very democratic when you are writing. We want Butterfingers to hit the winning goal. he's the hero. You will disappoint people because that is, I'm targeting children, and children want their heroes to succeed. If I were to make Butterfingers lose, I do make him get involved in ties sometimes. They do lose initial matches, but the final is a little, you know, it's, I can't do that because it leads to huge disappointment. Now I have to think of how the reader will react also. And for one person who is happy, there will be hundreds who are unhappy. See, in the first book, there is this man, Colonel Natkarni, who dies. He dies because I needed to kill him. because he has written the playground on which the students play belongs to him, not to the school.
Yes.
And he has written it out in his will that when he dies, the playground will go to him. And so that is the conflict in the story. He dies and they can't find the will. And there are matches and so on. So I needed to kill him. But I made him 76 years old. I made him die in London. I made him die in his sleep. I didn't make him undergo any pain. So
the nation may not have developed so much.
But what I want to tell you is that I got so many letters from children saying, why did Natkarni die? Oh. You made him such a nice character. We all loved him. And then he dies. See, there was a boy who told me he read the book in the library. And when he came to this part, he put his head down on the table and he said he cried. So I was so, I felt so bad. I never thought that the reactions would be like this. And I decided I'm not going to kill anybody in my books again if the children are going to react in this manner. So I'm sure if I make Amar lose the final, I won't hear the end of it.
Yeah,
but like,
it's not going to be easy because I believe, yes, one thing is we always, as a writer, I'm sure you always have the choice that whether we really need to be too realistic or we need to give the children that slice that, okay, you know, whatever be the conflicts at the end, you come out winning, right? In whatever, whichever be the situation.
That makes you feel good, doesn't it, Sunita?
Yes, absolutely. And so definitely, we are not, so I was just thinking about, you know, how we have, it's of course, it's not like an analogy, which is like very connected, but I was thinking like Butterfingers is not common man. Butterfingers is someone who is there to show
that
us.
That we have to leave to R.K. Lakshman.
Yes, lead us. And okay, you can be like me and you can win. So that's great. So please keep him there winning every time and making a significant difference, because I believe more than success, the significant difference that you can make, that is what stays with the children and as they're growing up. And that's great in terms of values and in terms of learning. So I'm going to ask you a question which is slightly off. So it's a simple one. What are you afraid of?
Afraid of with respect to my writing or in general?
I'm giving it to you. You can, writing, of course, you can tell me. Okay, one thing about your writing and one thing in general.
Writing, it's only, I'm afraid, I hope nobody will say that I didn't like your book at all. Okay. That is something I'm afraid of. Because I'm writing to, not just to satisfy my creative creativity or to write something that I want to write. For me, the process gets completed only when the reader reads and responds.
Okay.
So I'm not saying that everybody must rave about my book and say it's wonderful and so on. But I would be really cut up if somebody said I hated your book. So that is something that I just hope never happens. It is, you can say, a fear. Otherwise, what am I afraid of? So many things, Sunita. There are so many things you are afraid of. But to be very contemporary, I'm afraid of the floods.
Being there.
Yeah. Being here. And because in 2018, during the great floods in Kerala, water actually got into our house. It has been my greatest nightmare, you could say. It was my nightmare coming true. It was so frightening. It was only about 6 inches of water, but all over the house, you can imagine how it is. You know, every part, from the back door, front door, water was just creeping in. It was so frightening. And we could do nothing. We just sat and watched. Of course, when we knew it was coming, everything, we started piling up, you know, on higher levels and those kind of things we did. But that was so frightening. So that is something that I'm afraid of, and it did come true. So
I think I'm terrified. You know, at the end of the day, we realize that, okay, we are mortals and there is someone else. Nature is there, and anytime
anything can happen. Nature keeps hitting back all the
time. We take our environment for granted. We do so many things. And then when we face a flood or we face anything unfortunate, any calamity, we realize we shouldn't be taking things for granted, no matter whatever. Even with AI and all that, nothing happens at the end of the day. You're at mercy.
Yes.
Nothing, because the network doesn't work.
That's it. And just thinking of a time when we don't have enough power to keep us going. What will happen? I'm sure much after our time, probably we'll all go back. We will regress into how we were long back.
Like, I really knew what would happen, and you'd be very apprehensive and knowing.
So many things. So you're so true in what you're saying.
So we must learn to revere nature. That's what I feel. You know, okay, at the end of the day, that yes, you're there. And
yes.
Okay, so I'm going to come back to your book. And I'm going to ask you about this little habit. So the question is, like, you know, in today's world where of instant gratification, you know, you have a social media, like you have a tweet and everything happening. So how important do you think is this habit of reading books? Of course, for all of us, not only for children.
Very, 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 very important. You're asking me, Sunita, who I'm a chronic reader.
Book, not like reading. I'm going to take up both. So one is, we have this option of reading.
Yes.
I myself prefer this all the time.
Yes.
But you can please share your perspective.
Like you, I also prefer the heart. I'm showing you my tongue in cheek. this is a book that is right there on top. So that is very, what you say is so true. And I would say, not just because we are so dependent on technology. Reading should always be there. It has got a huge role to play in what we are, in how we are, how our ideas develop, how broad-minded we are, how we get to know what's happening. See, there is so much ignorance around only because people are depending only on WhatsApp messages. They don't even try to find out what is actually happening. Why don't you read good books which tell you about it? You were talking about environment, nature. We have brought this on ourselves by ruining nature. We should know, we are answerable to that. We should be held accountable. If we are having all these problems, climate change, this, we can't shirk our responsibility. But at least know why this has happened and make amends by reading nonfiction, wonderful books which tell you about this. And when you want to entertain yourself, you don't have to look into the screen all the time. See, even when before this much of technology reliance happened, we were always afraid of something coming and stopping reading. Yes. It happened when the radio came. It happened when the television came, when the television was invented. But the book withstood all this. Then we have the computer. We have the computer games. We have this total reliance on the screen. We have the mobile, which is a single instrument entertainer. You can see movies. You can do anything with the mobile. You can even read on the mobile phone, but I'll always prefer the physical book. Like somebody said, the sharks existed before, you know, and they still exist. So the real book, the book, actual book is like the shark. I don't particularly care for the analogy. I would have liked a better creature, but you have to be truthful to facts. And it still is there. Dinosaurs have gone, everything, you know how many animals have become extinct, creatures have become extinct, but the shark remains. And in that way, this hardy book will remain because it is going to give you so much, but mostly because it is a sedate activity.
Yes.
It entertains, it does so much, and it helps your brain. You're not, it may be a solitary activity, but you are at the same time with so many people. It's a strange, we need to know we are not alone. That's what C.S. Lewis said. So that is why we are alone, we are not alone. That's a kind of a paradox. So that is why we love reading, and reading makes us fresh. So many things it does to you. But when, as a teacher, I'm sure if you ask a child, why should we read? they will come up with a string of reasons. They say, ma'am, it increases our knowledge. It increases, it improves our vocabulary. Our grammar becomes perfect. We get new ideas. We use our imagination. If they start telling me this, I'll start with first, we use our imagination. Mm-hmm. But the answer I want from them first is we read to enjoy ourselves. We read because we take joy in reading. We read because we love reading. And all the other things, all the other advantages are happening naturally.
Just happening.
Naturally. Yeah, just happening. And because they are happening when we are doing something we love, mm-hmm. those remain. Yeah. It's not like somebody is forcing us to do it. And especially at such a time, I think it has a great role to play. Reading. Very, very important. We should make a concerted effort to get people to read, to forget about how terrible life has become, how different life has become, the challenges of life. Not that I'm not saying we should be escapist. But we need to get this kind of recreation in our minds, which is very important.
In fact, it just came to my head as you were saying, you know, because I do a lot of role playing. Next time, of course, Priyanka is there and Stingy is there. We could have, you know, actually have some of your characters being role play. So then the book is actually put into you, you know, where they come as that character of the book and they say something or they act out a situation or even, you know, you have together, you can have that, you know, each reading out a certain extract with a little bit of emotion.
I would love it.
Yeah, so that would be great, you know, where you have the children living the characters, yeah. which they adore, which otherwise they don't get a chance.
That's
so
right.
That would be a way to put the books to good, the reading to good use, you know, where it is not just individualistic reading. It's more like coming together, collaborating.
Coming together, correct. And in fact, because you were stressing on environment, nature, my love for nature and environment has made me write a lot of animal stories.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, very different from Butterfingers. Mm-hmm. That's how it works. So as a writer, this is all that I can do.
Well, definitely. I think writers are great influencers. And you are influencing, a stage where they are evolving. They're growing up with that. So that's so important. And not only the ones who are growing up, I always believe that, you know, we always keep on evolving. We keep on learning. I'm not talking about physical growth because it is something which is natural. You know, it's nothing to do with my biological, clinical. But that's talking about the growth mindset.
Your minds.
Yeah, so that is something which doesn't have an age or an expiry date.
True. Every day we are learning something.
And we are also unlearning so many things.
Yeah, correct. Very good. I'm glad you put that. You brought forth that. It is very true. We are unlearning. Because so often we think we are right about something. And then we realize, there is something else, another point of view. We should be willing to do that. Listen.
Yeah, and gracious enough to accept, maybe I was wrong there.
Yes.
And fine, it's okay. But so I think all this comes when we read and we understand.
Yeah.
And also we become, your books also another thing, apart from humor, it teaches us empathy. It's different, very different from sympathy and pity, you know, where I take but empathy, trying to understand what is happening and then taking an action or then reacting or responding. I won't say reacting. That is a great lesson. I think that's a huge value because empathy is one of the key skills what we need in today's world, not only for students, but even for our careers. It is required.
Yes.
It's a wonderful thing. So your ideation secret. I'm sure there are so many over you want to know. So does it just happen? It just comes, you know how we have the light bulb over there?
Yes.
Or whatever light bulb. Or
that's what in comics they do, right? When an idea, you have a light.
Yeah, something. Or it's just, you know, you make your little notes and it's planned or you doodle something. How does it happen?
There are different ways. There's no one standard way in which I get my ideas.
Yes.
Sometimes I get ideas from anywhere because I like to keep my eyes and ears open. Okay. When I'm listening to someone, I like to be a listener. When you're listening to somebody talk, something drops from them, which I think could be what I can elaborate on in my inner story. I have a book in which I write down all these little ideas that I get. Okay. See, the other day I was walking on the road and I saw from the gate. You know, the gate was closed, but there was a broom that was out. You know, somebody was sweeping, and there was a part of a broom was out. So I just thought, what if Butterfingers were there? He would step on the broom. And that was all. But I actually noted it down. I thought, okay, from here I can develop a story and what happens because of that and so on. It's just a stray incident. So I write that. That's one way. Another is when I actually sit and create a story. So I wanted to write a book, a story. I had this animal story collection, The Lizard of Oz and Other Stories. And I thought of writing a story about a lizard. I thought of it only because I was, for some reason, Wizard of Oz, I just came across and I thought Lizard of Oz. So I got the title, no story. And I thought, I got my idea just by actually sitting, thinking. Just like you have your students thinking about a story, yes. You give them the topic and they think. So I had the character, I had the title, and I had to think up a story. And I did think up a story. So you can think up a story when you have a title. You can think up a story when someone throws a challenge at you, as they did, as child did when I went to a school. Mm-hmm. He said, "How do you get your stories?" He asked me. I said, "I get them from anywhere. A small stray incident is enough. I can build a story around it." So he said, "Shall I tell you, give you an incident? Will you write a story?" I said, "Okay." And he said, "All right, Butterfingers is writing his exam. His desk is by the window. There's a huge gust of wind and his exam paper goes flying out of the window." A nice Butterfingers. Yeah. And then I said, "Very interesting." And then, and you know what his response was? "And then you think, you write."
That's you children always manage to, you know, just you don't even think like that the way they think.
Yeah. So I had to think. I sat and thought, and that was just one incident. And finally, I wrote the story. You must read it. It's a fun story. The mystery of the history paper. And I had to craft a story where this is one incident. It is a trigger, you could say. But I had to think of so much. You know what? How a story develops.
Yes.
So the people give you, I get a stray incident in my head. Somebody tells me something. I have a title. But the actual creation, it doesn't just come like that. Suddenly you can get an idea. But the rest of it is hard work. You have to think and plot and put it together. And the readers only get the finished product.
There's a lot of hard work.
They so much of hard work.
The narrative line, the plot.
But there is no just one method for the way I get my ideas in different ways. Sometimes it is just like a revelation. Sometimes it is just an idea that comes in the middle of the night, maybe. Always at awkward times when you're having your bath and in the kitchen.
Yeah. Washroom is a great place for idea. I remember seeing it in my office outside the washroom. This is where ideation happens. You know, with awkward baths. But I'm seated in the office washroom. So obviously the next question which comes as a part of it. Priyanka, I hope we have the time. Can I ask?
Yeah.
I hope you have with the time.
Yes, we do have. Yes.
Okay. Yes, ma'am. Okay. Yes, ma'am. We have the time. Okay. We have another, I think 5 to 10 minutes now.
How many minutes, she said?
10 minutes. 5, 10.
Yes.
10. And we need
10 minutes. We can stretch to 10 minutes.
Okay. So my obvious question, it's of this, that as you're developing, as you're writing, so do you face the writer's block? And if you face, how do you find the solution?
Yeah. I would define writer's block as a period of time when you're not happy with what you're writing, or you are not able to proceed when you're writing something. But I would not, I wouldn't say that I would stop immediately. Okay. Because what I feel is, if you feel like that, which can happen, because when you are writing, see, all my books were written under contract, all of them actually.
Yes.
And so I know there is this deadline.
Yes.
Many months, must be 6 months I may be given now once the contract comes. I know it's there. And I don't, like Ruskin Bond, every day, so many words in the morning. I don't do it that way. I write whenever I get the time, but the story is in my head. I work it out in my head. I'm carrying my story, my book, my whole book in my head. That's why I might sometimes have a very, you know, vague, vacant look on my face. And I keep thinking about that book all the time. And then I write. So when you're doing it like that, sometimes you come to a point where you're not happy. Something, yes. It's not progressing, or you're not happy with the sentence, you're not happy with what you've written, you get very frustrated. And what I do is, for a little while, I just stop. But I come back to it immediately. And I still feel the same. Mm-hmm. But I write. I may write something which is very simple, which is not satisfied at all. But I don't stop writing because I know that if I stop, I will use this as a luxurious excuse not to write for some time. I've got writer's block.
So you keep persevering.
Yeah, I do that. And after a little while, because I'm thinking of it all the time, I think of better sentences. I come back, I revise, I delete, I redo. I do all these things. Thanks to the computer, it's so much easier to do this. And then you start again. But what I feel is that writer's block is very often, it happens, but I don't think you should allow it to overwhelm you and allow it to take over your mind. Because then it will only delay everything. You will only lose confidence in your writing. Keep writing. Keep doing whatever you're doing. And then you will strike gold after some time.
Yeah, I think because it's your passion, I think, and of course,
yeah, maybe
the contract and all that is different, but at the end of the day, it's your passion. So it I think self-motivation.
Correct.
It's amazing that you carry the entire story in your head. I mean, that's so good because we carry so much stuff. I'm not, and it's there. So, and you don't get confused because you're doing so many things. You are doing work at home, you're teaching this, and you're writing. It's not just one thing. You're doing so many multiple things. And yet the storyline is there.
Yeah.
That tells a lot about your passion. And I can understand that very streamlined thinking. I think that's a skill which we need to develop, right?
Maybe. I don't know because I don't know. I'm not conscious of it. It's only when people ask me that I realize that this is how I'm doing things. But I don't find it that difficult. In the sense that if it's a novel, it's much more difficult. It's a huge book. So you are thinking of, you have to link everything and you are thinking of it all the time. But it is there. It is your creation, isn't it? You're writing it. So it's part of you. I'm not saying it's effortless, but it is not very stressful either.
Yeah, because they are, as you rightly said. So coming to that, what you said. So all these books, your creations, they are like your babies, right?
Very close. Your babies, yes.
So if you had to pick one, being a mother, I know it's not difficult. It's even not very easy.
Very difficult.
I'm going to reframe the question, not to harm any maternal sentiments. But if you had to pick anyone who is slightly more closer,
very difficult. This is what children are very scared of. You know, parents playing favorites. And I come from a large family where there have always been babies. So you love all babies. That's how it is with me. So I love all my little babies. This book,
Tongue-in-cheek, yes, for
I have a special liking for it because it's my first book for adults.
So that's the only thing, a slightly more connection. It's not that any love is lost over here, just because it's your first book.
And also I like it because it's all about what happened to me and the fact that people have empathized with it. It's all fun things that happen.
Yeah, I was reading the reviews are fantastic. I was reading it with the reads and Amazon, the way they have actually told about the daily snippets, how you have managed to transform it and make people laugh. I think that's amazing.
Yeah, because it started off as a column. So for me, it was very challenging. Every fortnight, I had to think up a humor an article. No, just part of this humor column. But at that point, I was always thinking of what will I write? My next humor column. And then somebody asked, what an eventful life you lead. All these things happen. I said, they're not great things that happen. If you look at, I don't want to spoil your fun when you're reading, like going to a hotel, ordering something wrongly, a pressure cooker lid bursting, finding a snake in the house, in the garden. But it is how all these things happen, but it is how you exaggerate and how you put it across. That is where the humor part comes in. So for me, some of those were a little challenging in the sense that you can't just be humorous. You can't make it forced. So because it came rather naturally and because it's been so well received, it's gone into this sixth reprint. So that is making me very happy. So I have a special affinity for this, as I have for House at Butterfingers, which is my first novel. Yeah.
Thank you for sharing that. Now, So here we have so many, your audience here, and we have so many. So what would be your advice for the budding writers, you know, kids who want to write, even adults like me, if I have to write tomorrow, I love to write, but I don't get the time to write. And by the time I sit down, I'm so exhausted. So what would be your advice to one who really want to, you know, write and make a difference, be it fiction, be it nonfiction, be it critical writing, anything? What would
The first thing I would like to say is be a good reader. You have to keep reading. You find small children wanting to write.
Yes.
You can't. And also, I don't want to blame parents, but I would say they have a role to play in getting these books published. Because a child then has a false idea of his abilities. You should encourage it, but don't overdo it. Encourage the child to keep writing, but also to keep reading, because that is what is going to hone your skills. When you write, when you read a variety of books, fiction and nonfiction, you are actually, like I told you, our mind is a very wonderful place where you are actually filing it all. You're not aware of it. But different ideas, different people's perspectives, different points of view, different motivations, different styles, different ways of writing, different points of view. So many things are there in different books. All of them are actually helping you. You're reading for fun, to enjoy yourself or for edification, whatever. But all this is actually unconsciously helping you. So when you write, you will develop your own style. But it will be because of this foundation of reading that is there. So the superstructure would be writing. What I would like to say is, for the budding writers, one, compulsory, you have to read. And that is what will make your grammar also perfect. You need to write good grammar. You can't get away with bad English. Yeah. And vocabulary improves your vocabulary. All those other things which are necessary for good writing. Don't be in a hurry to publish your books. And write, as I said, look around you. Keep your eyes and ears open. When something, some idea comes to your head, write it down. Elaborate on it. And don't think that you are, I write poetry well. Don't think that poetry is your forte. It could be a novel. It could be a short story. Experiment with different
genres.
Yes. And then you will realize what is good for you. And show it to somebody. If it's a child, show it to a teacher.
Like a checklist happening. Yeah, Priyanka, I think we should note this down somewhere, you know, a checklist, and please share with us. Okay, and I'm going to be on my own place. I'm going to start about this. That's so I'm just going to ask that. Thank you. I mean, that's wonderful what you shared, very practical. And one last question. Looking at the future, so we don't have a crystal ball, but imagine myself, crystal ball gazing. What's happening next as far as readers are concerned? If you can just share something with us.
What's happening next is the next book is happening next.
Yes. Okay.
So there's a book coming up, which is the second book for adults. Yeah.
Okay.
So that is a travel book. It's nonfiction, a humorous travel book. It's coming out in January. The edits are happening. Okay. And the title is Chuckle Merry Spin.
I'm going to copy. It's going to be really, really, I mean, I'm looking forward to reading. I'm not asking that which are the places you're going to mention and what.
Yes.
Maybe you might not want to spill it everything right now, but definitely I'm going to look to forward to that book.
I hope you enjoy it. It is a fun account of my of our travels, actually, my husband and I, to the US. I've told you now where.
But it doesn't matter. I mean, I know US is there everywhere, but your perspective is not everywhere.
Right? Yeah, that's yes. That's how it is. Chuckle Merry Spin. You know, it's a spin-off of Huckleberry Finn. Yeah, Chuckle Merry Spin. Yes.
So the classics remain with a contemporary twist.
With a twist.
Yes, that's wonderful. Yes.
That is how it is. Very nice talking to you, Sunita. You made me feel it. It was like we were just having a private conversation with so many people eavesdropping in.
I don't know whether people are going to be happy or not over there. But I realized that, okay, we are live. We can do those role plays and extract readings, you know, and that would be great. When you can have the author actually.
I'm sure Sunita is going to have a lot of ideas to implement in her school right there. I mean, it was lovely listening to you. We have a few questions from, I have one question coming in from Abin.
Okay.
Abin is asking, do you think COVID has an impact on the stories for children?
Yes, in a sense it has, because there have been quite a few writers who have written books which are based on COVID experience. I think Paru Anand has come out with a book. There are Sudhamurti is coming out with a book on COVID. So COVID has changed life, especially for children, because they are confined to their houses. They have everything is online. Classes are online. It's a very difficult period. See, a child has to go out, has to have the classroom atmosphere, play in the school playground. See, all the things I'm writing about in Butterfingers, they are not able to experience now, because they are sitting at home and doing this. And also quite few children are getting depressed too, because we hear about that. It's a very sad time. And sad in the sense it's very unexpectedly this happened. We were not prepared for it. And it took us unawares, and it kind of threw us into the pool, asking us to swim or sink. And therefore, it has changed. I wouldn't say that everyone is writing about COVID, but quite a few writers are writing about COVID. And I was actually toying with the idea of writing one or two stories of Butterfingers about COVID, because people have asked me, how do you think Butterfingers will face COVID? Because Butterfingers is such an outdoor person. What is he going to do inside the house? Then I decided, no, I'm not going to do that. I'll write about something else which will take the child away from COVID. Why do you have to keep talking about COVID? There's enough of COVID around. Though it has changed the scene to a certain degree, because writers are, Vaisi writers are actually the spokespeople of what is happening around. And naturally, they will think about it and think more about it and bring it out in different ways. Lots of books are coming out about it. It has changed the scene. But the other writing is also happening. It's not like we are having only COVID writing happening. You know, COVID, about COVID is not always the subject. So change of scene, I would say that there is kind of a split. There is COVID inspiring some books. There is also the other opposite process. No, we should go away from COVID. We should think of something else. Let's be cheerful. Let's think of how life was before. And let's think of how life will be after COVID. And let's go to that. As writers, we think of different perspectives and different topics. Yes, okay. Are you happy?
Yes, I think that answers. Also, there's another question from Shweta.
Yeah.
Any suggestions on how to help kids improve their grammar? As not the schools around these days use the right grammar while speaking.
That's exactly what I was saying. Read books. That's the best way to improve your grammar. You take the nursery rhymes that you grew up on. Jack and Jill went up the hill to fetch a pail of water. Jack fell. You don't say Jack, but Jill went up the hill. It is always Jack and Jill. You find that the grammar is correct. The words are correct, right in the right place. The tenses are correct. So unconsciously, you're getting better at this. And the child learns, picks up language very quickly. See, they are wired to learn languages. That's why they say, learn as many new languages as possible when you are very young, because you can pick up languages very fast. So I think that is the best way, my dear girl who asked the question, read books. because that is one way in which you can introduce the child to good grammar. There are good grammar books, but then it becomes very mechanical. And if you're talking about English, English grammar is full of exceptions. It's a very exceptional language, right? English. And you have one rule, and then you will have 10 exceptions. You'll have another rule and so many exceptions. For a newcomer to the language, it's very difficult. And it's not a phonetic language either. So it's very challenging to perfect English. The best way in which you can improve your language skills, grammar, vocabulary, construction, logical placing of ideas, all that will happen if you read books. You don't have to read grand fancy books, simple books, all right, but good books. Books written by authors who are standard authors, not good language. Listen to good English. Speak good English. Watch good programs. English programs. These are the ways in which you can improve your language. Also have a grammar book handy. If you have a doubt, you can refer to that. So I think that way you can really improve your language.
Okay, that was a good one actually. And yeah, we miss out. I can include myself also in the same that in last 2 years I've missed much reading and, you know, all the online stuff and all. But yes, we reading should be consistent. You know, we should build that habit of reading, and consistently we should read, I feel.
Yes, thank you, Shweta.
Thank you, ma'am. That was very, very valuable response, especially in the COVID times where as a parent, you have been exposed to all the teachers. You can hear them speak. And when teachers around are using incorrect English or incorrect grammar, then you just wonder what your child is going to pick up.
Exactly. Teachers are now under the scanner. You know that. Because parents are listening to the teachers teaching.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah. So
you mentioned a reference book for grammar. I have never come across this. Do you mind giving any suggestions here?
Offhand, I cannot tell you. Shall I send you a couple of good books on grammar, which you can share?
Sure.
Yeah. I'll send Snehi or Sunita. Or Priyanka, whoever.
If I may just pitch in over here.
Yeah.
We talk about grammar. One thing I think we are all familiar with, Renan Martin has always...
Renan Martin is old hat.
Old hat. It's old hat.
It's new one. Totally outdated. Then after that, we had a lot of other writers.
There's another one, Oxford Grammar. That's also
Oxford Grammar is there.
That's a good one.
Grammar is a good one. Maybe you could use that.
Okay, Oxford Grammar is definitely good. And another thing which I would like to point out, because we are talking about grammar, with American English coming in and British English being there, there's a lot of confusion about the application and the usage.
Yes.
So what are we following? If you're following British English, then of course we have that.
Well, I'm a very British English person.
Yeah.
And the computer also, it keeps on throwing up United States.
Yeah,
United
it shows States everything in the time.
Yeah. They don't believe in double L's. They don't, it's always shortening for them. COLOR, it'll be marvelous, will be with one L. It's that's how they are. But I would still call it a spelling mistake. And also realize, S-E-Z-E. You have them having a different take on spelling. I would say you should be uniform in what you are writing. And maybe because we have grown up on British English.
Yes, that's the reason. I think
that is the better English. I hope no American is listening. And and we prefer to use that English.
Yeah, I'm still for British English all the time. Yeah. We have everywhere, you know, even the software is American English. So you have everything in red whenever you write in British English.
Exactly.
You're trying to correct it.
I try to make it UK and then it jumps back to US.
And you add it to the dictionary, then maybe it helps at times.
Yeah. That's you can't keep on adding everything to the dictionary, but I do that too. Yeah.
Okay, that was quite helpful. Even I will look forward to refer these books. And we have another question from Bookaholics Book Club. She asks, who is your favorite author and who inspires you to write?
My favorite author, I already said, it is P.G. Woodhouse, my all-time favorite. But I have a lot of other authors whom I love. I love all Charles Dickens, old ones. I really love them. Jane Austen, Charles Dickens, all those great worthies. And modern, I love Arundhati Roy's prose. I love her books. I love Marquez. And I said, as far as humor writing is concerned, Bill Bryson is my latest favorite for humor writing. But you asked me for one favorite writer, so it has to be P.G. Woodhouse. So I'll give him that honor of being my favorite writer. And who inspired me to write? Nobody really, because I told you that I wrote just like that by sending an entry for a competition. But the fact that I won a prize for that and subsequently followed that up with some other first prizes, that encouraged me. And an editor, the editor of Tinkle, the assistant editor of Tinkle, actually came to my house after my first book got the second prize. I mean, first story. That was a huge moment for me. Imagine an editor coming to your house on the basis of one, not miserable, one story. And it's because she was in Mumbai and her in-laws were in Trivandrum. She came here, she traveled here, and they told her, go and meet this lady who wrote this book, but the story Butterfingers, and find out if she's as bubbly as her story. That's what she told me. And she came with my address. I mean, who would do that? Take the trouble to come to my house. And she told me, she asked me if I'm sending an entry for the next year's competition. I said, no. And she said, why not? I said, I've already got a prize. But that is how low my ambitions were. And she said, no, you have to write. We go by the quality of the writing. And it is fine if you have got a prize. We will consider every entry. That encouragement made me write. I would actually, if I'm a writer now, I would give all the credit to that lady whose name is Prabha Nair, who encouraged me to write. So more than inspiration, it was more encouragement that made me write.
That answers, I feel.
Book club, are you happy with that?
I hope so. Okay, and there's a being saying, when we start using a language, it becomes our own. Neither Britain nor American can claim it as their own.
When we start using a language, it becomes our own, you mean? I'm not quite happy with this attitude now of saying this chalta hai attitude. Anything goes. As long as you are intelligible, that is what has come because of this SMS language, this shortening everything. People think that if you are intelligible, it is all right. It is not all right. You have to aspire to good writing. You have to aspire to something that is good. It may be okay for you to communicate with your friends, but don't make that the standard for writing. When you write, the skills should be higher. You should aim higher. You should always make your language perfect. That should be your aim. Try to do that. Don't be happy with what your language is now. You understood. Fine. No, it's not fine. You don't have to speak in very prosaic, very grand language. Speaking is different. But don't make your speaking language, spoken language, your written language. There's a difference between the two. Sunita will know how different it is. And we must always aspire to reach there. Like all great writers, you look at the language of all the good writers. Who writes this Khichdi language? There are writers who write that, but they are not considered good writers. So you have to, we will always fall short. Nobody is going to reach there. But that's where we must aspire. Aim for the stars and reach the treetop. Or at least half the tree, you know, even if you don't reach the treetop, you can at least cling on to the trunk. So you have to keep on trying. And that's what I would like to say. The language becomes your own, but you try for British. Don't think of it as colonialism, please. It is not. We should be very grateful to England, UK, I mean, for coming here and teaching their language to us. Otherwise, we wouldn't. No, we wouldn't be so fluent in English. Look at China, struggling to learn English. It's very difficult for them. And because Chinese is a tonal language, it's very difficult. But for us, it's easy. And therefore, when things are easy, we should take advantage of that. So I would tell you, it may be, don't think that you're mixing British and American language and making it your own is enough. It is okay, but when you're writing, please write good British English, but if you want to write American English, okay, good American English.
Yes, I think that answers. Also, Jigna is thanking you for answering that.
Yes. Thank you for asking. I hope you don't mind my telling you this, because this is something I think you should be conscious of it, huh? That we must always ask.
Mine was satisfactory, yes.
Yes. Thank you.
Okay,
that's
any,
it. Yeah,
looks like. Okay, and it was really an amazing session. For me personally, I was personally looking forward to, and you know, waiting for it to happen, to hear from you, ma'am. And yeah, it was as amazing as it could have been. So, yes, I'm thankful to you for being here, for joining us. And
it was my pleasure, and I'm thankful to you for inviting me to be here with you, and it was a great joy. And Sunita, thank you so much for all the questions, and all of you who are here, all those who were watching, thank you very much, because It's because you're watching that we were talking. Of course, Sunita and I would have talked anyway.
I'm not dropping. They were actually listening.
Thank you very much. And I would like to wish you all the best. It's really creditable what you're doing. And Snehi, she looks like a schoolgirl. And when I heard that she's the one whose brainchild this was, I was thinking, my goodness, that is so nice. It is wonderful that she thought this up. And then she had a good team that took it forward. And now it will soon be established as one of the leading literature festivals. And that will be so good. That's how small acorns grow into oak trees. Let's hope you will become one sturdy oak literature festival. Wishing you all the best.
So that happens. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you from my side also. Thank you, Khyrunnisa. We'll be in touch.
Yes, please.
And, your humor, I'm sure I'm going to need them a lot because that's going to keep me alive and I need that. So I'm looking forward to the Chuckleberry now.
Yes.
I'm going to use that maybe by life. I'm going to take a lot of inspiration from there. And thank you. Very grateful to the audience. And also for the insightful questions. I think that was a great learning. We also had that great interaction. Thanks to each one of you. Great. Wishing Literati all the best. And
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much, Khyrunnisa, ma'am.
Thank you. Bye.